Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming today. My second demo is a pleasure to be here at Mosin. Yesterday, we did quite a bit of discussion on armor and some of my weathering, and we used this Hetzer here. I think probably some of you were in my demo yesterday, but I did a lot of discussion about my philosophies for taking the products that we have, streamlining the process down so the technique becomes a really efficient and powerful tool for each of us to use on our own work in the way that we want it to express the story of the vehicles that we're working on. Today's demonstration, I'm gonna branch away from armor, but I'm gonna show you some stuff with some other subject matters, but using the exact same techniques, the exact same tools, and the exact same processes. And that's kind of an important thing because I get many, many questions, gentlemen that do other subject matters versus the tanks, and they're like, well, how do I do this, how do I do that, and how do I do this? And there's nothing I do differently between the weathering of this, and the weathering of this, and then the weathering of this. There's nothing that changes in my world. The only thing that's changing to me is kind of the mentally, what it is I'm trying to capture with the subject, what is kind of the heart of the matter of where I'm going to present this at the end of the day for everybody to see, and those kind of a things. That's always what I'm thinking about when I do this. And so what I've tried to do over time from the books, through the professional work and the article writing, and as it transitions for about 10 years from now, I've tried to really refine my processes down so that I become as efficient as possible. And it's the process that I've become so efficient to be a professional that I learned and realized a few things along the way about what it is that we're really, really trying to do. And I know we have a lot of publications now where we have a lot of brands and a lot of products being displayed and all those kinds of things. And that's business, and that's fine. But when we're in the competition room and we're looking at the models and we're looking at what you guys are trying to do, you know, with this kind of a stuff, getting from a rock hit to the end solution there, and all this stuff is kind of thrown at us, I started to cut that all out. And I've talked about this before. I've talked about it a few times where I express how trying to become an efficient with a technique and then using the technique as your primary tool to tell the story. And that's kind of where this is all headed now. And this has been a transition of about 1 year for me from the last time I kind of did a lot of stuff in public using kind of the step-by-step that we're typically seeing. This is a new thing where yesterday I explained what I'm doing now is I work with the oil paints in particular straight onto a paint job that has a little bit of a hairspray and some chipping to kind of get the base paint effects in there. And I immediately start the weather from 1 to 100. I do the entire section here all the way through. And the reason I started to do this is what I found out was when I was doing the pin washes all over the model, one step, a filter, one step, decals, one step, you know, weather the decals, another step, and so on and so on and so on. The model never tells me the story when I'm working with it at those levels. So every time if I did this and I did my wash and did the stuff and it just sits there, and I've got to do other things, whether work or life or whatever, I'm going to come back to it and I have to do something else. I'm like, all right, now where was I again? What was I doing again? Like, what was my plan? And so we kind of go back and forth and back and forth with that in our heads. And so what I decided to do was really just kind of work a whole section all the way through. All the way through. Oh, yeah, sorry, that's in the paper. So I work a section all the way through with everything, every technique, the pin wash, the filters, the color modulation, all these new ideas, the old ideas, the dry brushing, the additional paint if I needed to do some stuff. And so eventually what would happen is I would have the whole story of kind of this area already completed. And then what I could do is I could step away. And when I step away and do my other things, I can come back to this Hetzer and I could continue a month later over here because I have my roadmap right here. And that's a really, really different thing when we do long-term projects. Most of us build models in months and years and all this kind of stuff. And when we do that, it's a little bit more powerful way to tell the story. It's a little bit more efficient, even though it may not sound like it is up front when you start to do it. And the other thing that I liked about it a lot was it was fun. I could see the whole thing being done. And that's kind of like, that's the excitement. Like I can get in here and I'm like, all right, that's really cool. And so I knew when I step back and I do my other stuff, or I, you know, come back to this model and here it is. And then I go, okay, you know, and then immediately I already kind of have a feeling for what was going on. And that was kind of a transition from the standard magazine writing publication stuff of step by step by step by step and with the various products and the various stuff. And the problem that I also had with that, when we always talk about it, and we see it a lot, is that becomes repetitive. It becomes boring, it becomes repetitive, but the work itself, your work, the stuff that you do year after year after year becomes, it's a different kind of a plateau. But if you have a process that you can control the storytelling elements of the model in a more refined and controlled process style with the techniques and stuff by just refining the stuff, what happens is your work, this model can be extremely different than this model because I'm not using the same level of products all the way through. And that's kind of what happens outside in the contest table. You see your models with the same level of wash, the same level of filters, the same level of pigments, because we're kind of told to use all this stuff. And so what I'm trying to do is to give you guys a process, a mental process mostly, that transitions from that level of model building that we're very used to into something where now you guys can start expressing your work and you see a reference photo or you see something in the real world that you really want to capture. Now you've got a little bit more of control to handle that, because when you try to do it all as one step, it's hard to control so it looks like the old truck outside. You know, that kind of an idea of trying to blend those two things together, what it is that you want to capture. And so this way, I can kind of work all the way through and get what that, like the, if there's a reference image or something like that that I'm working with, I can capture that here in a short period of time, in one session. You know, this was a little bit in the hotel room and a little bit yesterday in the demo. And so now, in a really short period of time, I've captured something that I wanted to get out of my subject matter, and now when I step back, I can come back into it. And now I can kind of see what I've done. It talks to me again, it tells me what's going on. And this way, I can also kind of develop my own, okay, I want to go more extreme with this, or I want to go less over here, or I want to change this over here because I see how this is, and now I start to be able to modify what I'm doing. And that becomes the power of when you see the newest work from somebody that's kind of starting to really be a good storyteller, you'll see the advancements in the work, you'll see the interest that you guys will have, like, that is just so cool, whatever that's happening. And that's kind of where it breaks us out of kind of just build a kit, put it together, we do our washes, we do our stuff, da-da-da-da. It kind of breaks that apart a little bit for us. And it kind of, sometimes like when movies get really repetitive, and series movies, you know, all this stuff, it's like we see the same thing over and over and over, and it's like, all right, we've seen that 1,000 times. I can only see Iron Man blow up stuff so many times. It's just, you know, so I think what's happening is just, there's gotta be versions of this, of what this model building hobby is all about for us, and each one of you has your own particular, specific thing that you're trying to do. And that's kind of where my job is to give you the tools, you know, to be able to do that. And that's really what this has kind of developed for me over the last couple of years with this. And for me, it's a lot of fun now, because now I can sit here and do this, and I can have a great time because I'm not boring everybody by just doing all these washes at one time and then come back and doing all this, the filters, and we've got the hair drying. Now you can kind of see from start to finish everything that's going on. And now you guys are like watching, like, oh, that's what he's talking about. That's what he's, you know. So like this whole fender and all this kind of stuff, it's like, when that happens, that's kind of like you guys take away from that, and then you go home and you're like, okay. And the other thing too is, it's not a right or wrong. It's not a I'm right or wrong, or you got to do the Michael Rinaldi way or anything. It's nothing like that. It's like you can take parts of this or all of this and put it into your own work, and you'll get back that kind of a thing. So it's a flexible system. You know, you could use traditional methods. You could do all those other things, but you can work in this way, and then maybe down the road, you know, you can do it 100% this way. You could do it 10%. So it's got flexibility. It's not structured. It's not anything more than a tool. And that's the beauty of what I think it really is about, is that it's just a couple brushes, some paints, some thinners, and it's just, you go. And what happens is, I went from, for example, these two legs here, they're painted with the paints. No varnishes, no nothing, no filters, no whatever. A little bit of hairspray, so just so I can get some basic chipping in there. And as I talked about with hairspray before, it just gives me a really refined control element to chipping. I tremble too much, my eyes are too bad. I just cannot get my hand chipping anymore. And I think the naturalness of it is really effective. So I can go from this in one day, and I can go from this onto this, and in the end of the day I can get this. And it's fully weathered to a level that I'm happy with. And then when I finish the whole entire, this particular Gundam model, when I finish that, I can also come back in and start to modify other things with more extreme weathering or less weathering or different effects that I want to do. But I can basically get a really, really good idea of what this is going to look like when it's done weathered. And there you go. And so then I can step away, I can do this, come back, and do these other things. And so it's the same thing here where on this side over here, there's really not a lot of work, but over here I spent about a half hour with some oil paints. And I've got, you know, a relatively fully weathered piece over here that I saw. Again, I can step away, come back. And so it's just not like a pin wash in here and some filters or whatever. Everything that we talk about with all those steps are all integrated at one time now. And that's kind of the change order for me. So in other words, I'm still doing my pin washers. I'm still putting filters on here. I'm still doing my chipping. I'm still doing all of it, but I've localized it down into a controlled element here where I can see this section, and then I can move on and do some other stuff. And boy, my hands always get messy. And so I can always, you know, this kind of, I can step back, there's my roadmap, boom. And if I'm doing a larger project, it also plays into that because you can kind of, if you've got multiple elements, you've got figures, you've got other vehicles, you've got bases, you've got groundwork and buildings and whatever it is that you're doing, this, even the littlest tiny little bit, will give you kind of the confidence to do what you gotta do, go away, come back, do your research, do whatever it is that you're really interested in doing with it, and you'll still have kind of, there it is for you. And that's that kind of mental switch. When I talk about the whys in the book, the why is the heart of all of this. We can all do A, B, C, D, E, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, put it together. We can all sand and glue, you know, primer, air, you know, airbrush paint, all that kind of stuff. And that's well and good. But when you're talking about building a story, the vehicle, and if it's the standalone, which is what I do all the time, the standalone, that thing's got to tell the entire story to the viewer because there's no figures, there's no context, there's no nothing. So I have to be able to express the life of that vehicle to you. And so all of these kind of things that I'm doing, that kind of simplistic technique becomes so powerful because I'm not concerned about 10 techniques or 10 props. I've got one or two, and then I can kind of push and pull and push and pull, and it really creates a power within my ability to finish a model. You know, whether I'm in front of you guys or whether I'm in a hotel room or whether I'm at home doing my stuff, it's a simple tool. So the complication of the model building, the complication of the finishes, the stress of the finishes, because I all know that when we're kind of sitting here doing this, there's the stress of it because you want to share it, you want to put it on Facebook, you want to put it in a magnet, whatever it is that you're doing, or put it on a table out there. There's the stress of it, and it's its own thing. So what I'm trying to do is reduce the stress, increase the positive attitudes, increase kind of, I know I can sit down and do this now. And that's what I'm trying to convey to a lot of you guys, are not at my level, but if you see this, and you'll see how simple I work, and you realize that when you go and do that yourself, it's not that hard. It's not, you know, this is nothing. Nothing I do is special or difficult at all. There's nothing here that I'm really doing. And I think if those of you who saw yesterday saw what I was doing with kind of, you know, taking a brush with a little bit of thinner, and I have another brush with a little bit of paint on it. You know, and this is just real quick, just to kind of illustrate. I get a little bit of color. You know, I unload it. I have a really, really fine, precise tool that I'm using. And that's kind of what happened was, I found out with the more precise the brushes, the tools that I use, the more precise and control I can have here. And that becomes from 1/35th to 1/43rd to 1/100th to 1/72, all the way through, 1/144th. Same tool, same brush, same paint, same technique. Simple for me. I don't have to stress. I don't have to worry like, how the hell am I going to do a Gundam because I do tanks? How do I, you know, that part of it, like, what am I going to do with it? You know, if you transition from something, you know, like Marin does a tiny 1/350 ship or 1/700 stuff and then does a 1/35th scale stuff, the things he does, the things people do, you do not change your processes too much. So by being able to kind of take this right here and then figure this out and then work it right here in a really simple way, all of a sudden everything kind of, so I could do these two things identical. There's nothing that I did different in here. This is paint, primer, hairspray, paint, oil paints. Hairspray, primer, da-da-da-da-da, oil paint, boom. There's nothing I've done differently. Same exact brushes for years now. Same oil paints that I've used for years now. All this stuff is the same for me. And now I'm able to maneuver between the two. And this is 72nd, this is 35th, and we'll get into some other stuff. And this is 1/144th. Same exact thing. And so now you look at it, and now, so here's the other side of it. Here's the flip side, and I talked about this yesterday a little bit, was the key to it is I want to see when I go outside there, I want to see whose model's who. I want to see the signatures come out. I want to see the personality of your efforts on the table. And what this does is that kind of gives you this power to kind of move past kind of the structured step by step and then start to develop your own personal styles. And that's something where I think a lot of you guys, because the quality of the room's amazing. I mean, this is, talked about this yesterday, there's the average quality out there is fantastic. It's fantastic. I was really impressed. But I still don't know who's who yet. And so when I go out and see this stuff, I want to talk to you and see this. I want to see who you are in your work. And that's kind of part of what this is, because you're the author now. It's like when you go to the bookstore and you buy a book, and that's exactly what this is. You know, my signature is on this now. And that's what I want to get from you guys, is that to pull you away from the similarities of everything we've seen for the last 5 to 10 years, and then give you it's the same wash, the same filter, same idea, and then just change it a little bit and click, and then boom, you guys can start to really express yourself a little bit more and develop something to where you're in control, you're confident about it, you're motivated, and then when you do it over a course of time, you have the less stress because this is sitting here for you already. It's already telling you what to do. Like when I get to this far, I'm already knowing kind of in my head, okay, now I know how, you know, when I go to sleep at night or if I'm taking a shower, whatever, I kind of know what I'm going to get to when I get into this over here because I've already started it over here, so I don't have to worry about it anymore. The first couple moments are a little bit, you know, it's always that initial where it's the blank canvas and then you kind of, oh, okay. But once the first half hour is done, you're fine, you know, and that's kind of what it is. So it's really just, like I said, it's the precision of the instrument, a little bit of paint, a little bit of color. You know, you come in here, you apply a little bit of color. You know, it's something really critical I talk about a lot is just the refinement of the process, you know, just doing some simple little work. I do a little bit of color, a little bit of blending. The hair dryer is really important because we don't want to sit there and watch all this dry. And so in a couple of seconds, I continue on the process, but just the concept that these two little things are extremely, extremely powerful. And I can tell the entire story of the project. It does get a little bit of a challenge if I'm on a 30-second scale aircraft and the wing is you know, a sizable piece of plastic, and that's a little bit different. And sometimes you will have to change your tools to adapt. But the actual process of a very precise amount of color in a very specific location, a little bit of blending to get the effect that you're trying to achieve, and then you just kind of, when you do that over the course of time, the first time it will be tough. You know, a lot of people are a little bit more heavy-handed. The first time is a little bit difficult, but as you do it more and more and more, it's like golf or tennis or anything else we do, you refine your techniques, you refine your processes, but the basic swing, you know, of the bat, as we call it, it's the same. And it's really what it comes down to is developing that, and that's kind of how I've taken my thing into the next level and what I'm really trying to do. So. That's the heart of the matter here, the philosophies that are at play, the mental work. And that's really, to me, kind of the joy of this now is it's seeing this, seeing what's happened. I can feel in my brain, I can feel it going off when I'm doing this. I'm like, okay, there's something happening here. There's something going on here. And there's something that if I can convey it to you guys, then that's something worth, that's value. There's something there for that. So as a hobby and everything else, and that's just something that I really enjoyed lately. So it's been a real fun thing, and I think if you guys embrace it a little bit or a lot, you know, whatever it is, it's great. But I think what I'm going to do next is I think we'll start with some die cast, and then we'll do the gun and kind of wrap it up. But so that's kind of where it's going. Feel free to ask questions at any point in time. Do not be afraid to interrupt me or, you know, ask questions as I'm talking, and because oftentimes it leads to better discussion and I know it's early in the morning and many of us have been out late the last couple nights, you know, Palinka and all that stuff. So anyway, what I do, the reason I wanted to bring a die-cast model today, one is to just demonstrate that, again, the techniques are applicable across the board. Two, it's pre-assembled and it's pre-painted. And a lot of us enjoy just weathering stuff and have some other things, but the die-cast market is quite large. I mean, they make die-casts of everything now. This is a 1/43 scale, I believe. And all I've done here is, before I brought it in, I just took a little flat coat, flat varnish, and just sprayed the gloss down so it knocked it down a little bit. And it also gives me a little bit of a texture, you know, because matte has a little bit of a slight texture to it. So it lets me kind of work some things. But one thing I really enjoy being able to do is just, if I'm practicing, if I'm doing some other stuff, sometimes it's a little bit easier to use a die cast to practice on just because it's already built, it's already painted. What I'm going to do is I'm going to kind of do some rusting and do another layer of paint and do some chipping and stuff like that. So I'm going to mask some of these windows off real quick, just so it's not terribly done, but it's not going to be beautiful. But, the reason I'm going to show you is I'm going to go backwards. Yesterday I didn't do any painting at all. We just didn't get to the painting. I really went philosophical on everybody for a couple of hours with the Hetzer. So today I'll do a little bit more painting. Some of this stuff's prepped. The Gundam's prepped. But on the Gundam, we'll put some bright colors against this. I'll put some graphics on this. Sir, and the little aircraft here was, there's a layer of primer, a color, over the plastic to seal it. And Gundams have their own world where the plastic is unique to the hobby. Sometimes it will dissolve if you're not careful. So I prime everything really carefully, thoroughly, so that I can do this. And then we'll have conversations about that too, because Gundams are unique in their own thing versus the armor and the aircraft. But what I do, again, it never changes. And then I can have that discussion with you guys, because it'll express to you because of the way the Gundams are and with the joints and the plastic and if you do a heavy enamel wash or something on it, sometimes it deteriorates. I can show you how to avoid that. And that's kind of part of this conversation too, is what I'm doing is also extremely safe for the model. I don't ever ruin a model anymore, and I don't even ruin the paint. So kind of one of those things we'll talk about is, so I'm going to show some painting today and some shipping, and I'll show you some quick hairspray stuff too. Because the hairspray in particular, you know, when Phil kind of came out with that and kind of brought it to our attention that year, 2007, very important you know, point in my hobby world, especially, was when, you know, that Panzer IV came out. It was just that change how I looked at things, and that was something I really thought on the finish side of things, on the painting side of things, how that happened and why he did that and what his goals were for that. That was something really important that I realized. So I'm just gonna make up a quick little rust color here. And while I'm doing that, I'm gonna spray a little bit of rust onto this guy, just straight on. I'll do a touch of hairspray over it. And then I'll put a little bit more of like an off-white on top of it, so we can get kind of a white-on-white with a little bit of rust, so that the top of this thing will kind of look like a faded little bit here. And then I'll do a little bit of same thing with the orange areas. So this is a time when you want to ask me questions, because I have to do a little bit of prep work. If you guys have anything you want to talk about,
feel free. How long does it take for one coat of oil color to dry? Dry to the point where you can put on another cloth on top of it?
Usually within minutes now.
Minutes?
Yeah.
Do you ever use cobalt dryers or something like that?
No.
Just ordinary oil color.
Because I think the key, and this is the key across all these pieces that we're going to talk about, there's so little color being applied. There's so little amount of paint that the evaporation process is so quick now. And the thinner is so quick, and then with the hair dryer. So I was able to work over this 3 or 4 times yesterday in the course of the discussion. So it was within a half hour to an hour. We went over this 3 or 4 times with different chemicals and different oils and a layer and layer and layer without affecting.
So you never had a problem with
washing away? Sometimes you do. Yeah, and yes, you will. It's not perfect, but at the same time, when you have the thinner and you have your brushes with that, the paper towel, and then you'll see me do this, and as I get into this more, I will remind you guys to watch my brushwork, watch my hands, watch how I dip this, and how I go here, and how I do this, and there's a rhythm, there's a dance happening. Watch it really closely, it's important. That's the difference maker. And so it answers your question, because what happens is, I'm using so little now, it really does not get to that problem too much. And if it is a problem, just the hair dryer, step away for 15, 20 minutes, put a varnish, do, you know, if you need to. Don't be afraid to. I don't like to, but if you have to, fine. It's not going to hurt anything there at the end of the day. So, but again, I'm working in such a small area. And the other thing too is, let me step back real quick before we get this, because it does help your question too. Is in particular with oil paints. This is my palette for the weekend. I had to make a new one because this one's starting to dry out. But so there's Wilder oils, there's Winsor Newtons, there's 502s. They're all basically the same. Wilder has less linseed oil inside of it, so it dries out a little bit faster. But the cardboard palettes, they're designed to pull the linseed oil out of the paint, because what we do not want that glossy effect, unless there's something you're actually trying to do. It'll eventually dry matte over time, but we want to speed. Everything I do now, I want to speed up. Those things, the drying parts of all of that. And so this process, which we get from the figure painters, they've been doing this for thousands of years, you know, they pull this out. And so now I've got much more pure paint here. And so usually, so this one here, it's taped to the table because I don't want to, I put a little piece of tape on the back, double side tape, put it to my table. Same with the, you know, so I don't, you'll bump into this all the time. Put a little piece of double side tape on this. It'll actually save a lot of headaches for you. So I use the tape all the time. You know, put a little piece on the bottom of all that. And so what I've done is basically I've created my colors. The colors here always relate to the project. So when you guys ask me what colors I'm using and stuff, well, it's like, well, what if I'm using the grill there and the three tone, I'm gonna have all my tones of the greens, all my reds, all my tans, all my yellows, and then all my darker rust and grease colors that I wanna put on it. So the palette is always kinda, and I always like to make a pretty little rainbow, and this is kinda how I do it, you know, just because it's easy for me to kinda look at this and okay, all my greens are over here. So when I get into my process of actually working this, the reason I do this is because it's very efficient for me. I know where all my dust colors are. And so mentally, when I'm kinda going and going back and forth, and when I don't have to talk to you guys about all this and I can really focus, then I get into my rhythm, you know, and that's kind of where, that's why the colors are always, my three Winsor Newtons are always in the same spot on the palette all the time. And I just get in that habit because I repetitively can instinctively do that. And then again, it's less stress because I don't have to worry about it. There's little tiny things like that make a huge difference in the daily routine of working on these models all the time. So, but again, the cardboard is essential. And it doesn't have to be the brown. I mean, anything like this kind of material, you really want to do it. Typically, a half hour to an hour is best. I think we've got about 20, 30, and you can see kind of, it goes from the dry, you can see it happening. When it gets to this level, that means it's probably really, really nice to work with. This dried out overnight. I didn't seal it back up like I should have. So, and some of the colors I could probably still work with, but some of the wilders are completely dry now, so. To your question too. So this model here, oil paint, no varnishes, no nothing. And I'm touching it, I'm holding it, nothing. So you can handle this stuff. It's not so delicate. Pigments are a little bit different. You don't want to touch when you move to pigments, then you kind of keep away from them. But for purposes of working with the model, I don't seal them. I don't, all this stuff with the varnishes. There's no reason for it for me because I'm using so small amount of material. And that's really a critical difference maker of getting the level of refinement down, because scale is what's gonna be your enemy. But whatever it is you're doing, the scale master will come in and okay, well, I'm 1/44th or I'm 72nd scale. And okay, now you gotta refine yourself to match the scale that you're working in. Because I'm going from 35th to 43rd to 72nd to one, always scale. Scale is the only thing that I look at. And I don't care if you like color modulation or you paint in black and white or whatever it is you're doing, I don't really care. But your scale of the effects is what I'm looking for. That's the challenge of everybody here. So it's, can we get down into the scales we're working in? And that's really, and so that's why the point of what I try to do is how do I get to a system that's flexible enough to allows us to do that? And that's really what this is all about. So that, you know, getting rid of varnishes, going to a different type of product selection, being able to maneuver, all these things play into it. And so when you apply this and you ask, well, how long do I wait and stuff like that, you'll start to see as you get used to it, it's minutes, a couple minutes. And you know, I can keep going and keep working this and it's fine. If I come back in with a lot of thinner, a lot of liquid thinner, yeah, you might affect it. You will definitely right away. And it might take a week or two to seal, but I unload, I look at my brush, and if I want to test how wet it is, I hit the skin. I'm getting just a tint of gloss, so I know it's got a little bit of thinner in it, you know. And if I need to wet an area, I'm just barely kissing that area. I'm not flooding the surface. I'm not soaking the surface with thinner. And so this will dry really quick. It will not leave the heavy tide marks. All these other problems that we've always been fighting for years, it doesn't happen. So when people ask me all this stuff, I'm like, well, I don't do anything, so I don't know how to answer your question, but I'm not doing anything. And the reason is because I'm not doing that. What I'm not doing is I'm not doing the capillary thing that we're all so used to seeing. You know, I don't do that anymore. Because what happens is, okay, you see down right here? That was the old school way of putting a pin wash, and there's a residual thinner drying. It did not go well. It's very even. Da, 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 da. Over here, I do. So when I do a pin wash, when I do these kinds of things, when I talk about control and precision, so I prep my brush. I get it almost. So when I do a pin wash, I come in here. And I kind of tap, I draw it in there. But you'll see that there's no thinner bleeding out. I don't have to come back in and blend this anymore. I don't have to do all those extra steps. So by reducing the amount of quantity of product that you put on the model, you can control it. And I can also control in the motion, the opacity here, all the way through, versus... This is, you know, the little bit... You know, this is even pretty, this is pretty refined, but you can see the gloss of the thinner come out. You know, when we do this, when we do these little guys like this, you know, this is the more traditional method of applying the pin washes. It's even highly localized, and this is something we see all the time. But you can see the circles of the, you know, you see the very, very common, this has happened to everybody. But over here, it never happened. And the reason is because I just do not have the material on the brush. And that's, you get used to that. Get used to not having any, the thinner brush, the blending brushes with the thinner on them, they're almost dry. And that's the difference here. And it actually, when you work in your session, if you have one or two brushes, the blending brushes that are clean with just a tad bit of thinner, just so you can move the oil paints around, really to get a lot of the gritty blended effects and stuff and to kind of, and you can see over here, see all the little, I mean, this is just a mess. You know, we always, like where I put the thinner up and I did that, it just keeps going. This is just a mess, it's a pain in the ass. And I got tired of all that too. You know, it just wore me out. This kind of thing, of, you know, where you got all these enamel bottles of, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4 browns and greens and whatever, all they have, and doing and applying and slapping it on there and just, you know, coming back in and, you know, here we go, let's get this, okay, here we go, yeah, okay. Come in here, well, you know, and this is what the problem's gonna be. Everybody's gonna do this. They're gonna blend it out. And so all the things, all these effects, every time on a section, if I did this process, every time on a section, it's always gonna look the damn same because I've just pulled it out and there's no life there. There's no, once you see it once or twice, you kind of have done it before. So by switching up and moving away from that and going to a very precise, a very controlled process, coming in here with just a, come over here, I can kind of maneuver. There's still too much thinner on the seat. And now I'm finding it already. So get that thing unloaded. Get a little bit more color in there. And I can make this little panel line, you know, just stand out a little bit different. And so when I move over here to this panel line, so, and that kind of is what's just happened is, in one efficient process here, I'm able to get a lot of variety in it right away. In this process over here, the standard process where I will do the capillary action and then I'll blend it out and then I will come back in and I will enhance it. It's 2 or 3 or 4 steps. And that's the traditional way that we've always worked and it's very common. But by switching it up and going to this process where you really are just, you're putting it exactly where you want it, when you want it, a little bit more, you create a little bit more an original thing up over here. This will be a little bit more original in this model. And then when I switch to another model, when I switch from another project to another one, or if I do 10 Hetzers in a row, I'm able to control and make this little section original. And that when you transpose that over the entire model, then all of a sudden they all start to have their own story, their own life, their own thing. Versus this way over here, it becomes very similar, very same, very repetitive. And you can control, you can modify. I did it for years. I'm guilty of it too. So I would have to come back and rework the section 3 or 4 times until I was happy. That's what I was fighting. I'm like, God damn, what is, really? I gotta do this again? Just, it never came out the way I wanted it to. And so by learning that in my head, I said, okay, well, now, let me work the entire thing through. Let me solve the entire problem of this right here in one session. And when that happened, that's when I realized what I can do with my models now. And so if I went to a Sherman, if I went to a naval sub, if I went to an aircraft, I can attack it with the confidence that I can control the entire thing. And when you can control it like that, that becomes a really, really nice little bit of stuff. And so, and you can see, so this side here, it's still trying to dry out. It's still, and I can hair dry it and stuff, but just this other side over here, you guys can like pass that around and look at it up close. It's, you can handle it, it's fine. It's just a test model. When you see that up close and when you can see what it can do, it's really something I want to beat into your heads a little bit, that you can really, change your world as far as what your end result will be. And this will be something that will motivate you, it'll inspire you, it'll inspire others, and all that kind of fun stuff. So that's kind of where this is all headed.
And when you build models like 1, 10, 20, what do you do not to fall into always the same thing, same routine, same boring thing.
Yeah, and that's the point, is because I want to be able to do that and not be the same every time.
And is there,
but still have my signature.
Yes.
You still know my work, and you know, you
and
still know.
If you build a lot, like 100 models, is there any danger that it becomes repetitive?
Yeah, always a danger, I think, personally. I think two models becomes a danger repetitive to me.
And models will look same.
Yeah, I find that always, that's my fear. You know, that's I want there to be a subtle change between the Stumhabitze and the Grill. I want there to be subtle changes because I'm trying to tell a different story with that one, but everything's the same kind of color scheme, the same basic stuff, but they stand apart. Because when I attack this one, I could address the research material I was using for it in a controlled way, because I knew, looking at what I was looking for in the photos and stuff and what I wanted to replicate, I could control that with this one, and then switch to that subject, very similar subject, but switch to that piece of armor, and still do the same techniques, but the results are different, because I'm modifying every little step as I'm. It's a really subtle little micro management, if you will, of the processes. So if I had done, you know, a pin wash over the whole thing, a filters, you know, pigments, those two would look much more similar in their end result. And when you get up close, there's a lot of variety in it. And it's a subtle thing. We're not talking massive degrees here. We're talking subtleties between similarities. If you do a lot of German armor or whatever your subject is, or a lot of old cars or whatever, you get kind of a personality with each project. And when the personalities come out with them, it can really excite you guys. You know, you get excited about it because, you know, or you see a photo, which is what happens to me like every day. You see like a photo or you see something go by you and you're like, it's like all of a sudden you take the snap picture in your head and you're like, ah, I want to do that, you know, and you want to do that effect that you just saw go by. And so that's something that being able to kind of know that, but and then in the back of your head, you know that you can do this. You know how to do this. And so that's kind of by refining everything down, able to kind of do that. I'll make a quick rust color here. Quick for you guys. I tend to be very neat too, a little bit, just so you guys watch me. My house where I work, this is about as messy as I get. So it's when you see all those workbench photos, I don't even put anything up because I'm like, I don't really do much. Because I keep everything, I'm just super fastidious and all that kind of stuff, so. Yeah, and that's actually pretty easy because you can look at a lot of civilian stuff. It's
but I mean, like one photo here, I like this. I want to do something like this one, not exactly, but something like this one. Did you have something? Because
for today, no. For today, I'm just. This is all bullshit today. This is me making this up today. So
I had a big problem. I was struggling very much because I just made models from head.
Yeah.
Just applying techniques.
Yeah.
And I realized that I'm not happy with the result, never. So for me, the only one way was to use a picture, like inspiration. I'm not doing this exact effect, but inspiration.
Just gives you the general.
Or two or three pieces of pictures, inspiration for the project.
Yeah.
And
inspiration everywhere, everywhere you look.
Then you know what are you trying to achieve, like something similar. Mm-hmm. So you adjust the techniques, so that's why I'm asking.
Okay. Yes, definitely. I look around all the time.
And I think that many modelers are afraid of many things if they are not good because they are just trying to do things from head.
Yeah. And that's a good point. I keep forgetting what I'm trying to do here with you guys. I'm sorry. I get sidetracked very easily. So. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put a little bit of rust color first onto this.
What is the tinning ratio is like?
So to speak about a product specifically, these are the new brand of paints, Mission Models from America. They've come out a couple of months ago. They're an acrylic, but they're a urethane-based acrylic, which is a very, very high-end chemical compound. Usually with a lot of the European acrylic brands, they're latexes or vinyls. And that's a much cheaper, lower quality product. So these spray and act like the Tamiya's when you use the lacquer thinners or the Gunzi thinners that we've been really popular lately because you can get some really nice airbrush qualities with some of the Japanese paints and their thinners. I had a little bit of hand in developing this product. I do the graphic design for it, which you can kind of tell if you know my graphic design work. It's the gentleman that does this is an old friend of mine that I used to work with, John Tamkin at Mission Models. And he's developed this line of paint, and then he approached me because we live in America, and we're close together that we can develop this to our standards, what we were trying to achieve. Because one of the problems I was having was with all these chemicals, the enamels, the lacquer thinners, all the stuff that we were doing, it's killing me. I mean, I think it's going to kill all of us. It's just not what we should be working with. And so I've transitioned personally to, in the last couple of months, from all the stuff you read about, now when I come in and tell you, I don't use lacquer thinners anymore. So basically, there's some changes I've been done on a personal level, and then moving to a pure acrylic system. And the ratios are precise. So typically when we talk as authors, I thin the paint 50-50, and you hear us talk about this a lot, this is different. So this is like a... to make a mixture for airbrushing for a session, 10 drops of paint, because they have a little, and it's nice, you can one hand this, so if you've got your airbrush, it's not even like the Vallejo where you have to twist it with the hand and those. No, this is even, and one thing people don't understand is with these little dropper bottles, flip it upside down, it creates a vacuum. And now I can count one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, so I can count my paint drops. And then the same thing with the thinner, and then you add a proportional ratio, and it's usually about 20%. So we tell you 10 drops, 2 or 3 drops of thinner, and then they have a polyurethane additive, which is like a flow enhancer a little bit. So if you really want to do a really refined, beautiful paint job, and not militaries, but I mean civilians, for aircraft guys, you add a couple of drops of the poly additive into it. And the level of finish that you get is, and this is all Mission Models paints, these right here, this is all Mission Models paints. So these are, started to really work with them. It's not my company, so it's not my brand of paint or anything like that, but it's just, I had a little bit of hand in developing them, which was kind of fun for me. And I can still do my stuff without being under pressure for a lot of things to do with the branded stuff. But it's a new addition to the marketplace, and I think even though, yes, it's another brand of paint, they're very high quality, and I think it's something a lot of you guys, when you get your hands on this stuff, I think you will enjoy them. So, and the tip drying's really minimal. You know how a lot of times with acrylics, the tip drying's a problem, always a problem. This is pretty nice. So
that's a 0.2 needle, or?
I think this is my O2. Yeah. And I'm just going to put a little bit of rust on here because we're gonna repaint right over this. I'm just trying to give me something here.
And how much pressure are you
using? Pressure is 12 to 15 PSI. So again, a lot of the stuff I do, this is a common theme. Everything is very limited, very controlled. My PSI, my compressors are low. I'm not spraying at 20, 25, 30. Everything I try to do, I guess I'm a control freak. Let's just call it what it is. And that's what's happening. And so I'm trying to convey that to you guys in particular. And so this is fun with the die cast stuff, I mean, if I was to take this to a really, really high level, that's fine. But right now, just for demonstration purposes, I'm not being, anything precise or whatever. Now I got to clean, so you have to watch me clean an airbrush out. yesterday I discussed this. I consider, for discussion purposes, for the purposes of explaining things, painting and chipping to me is one thing. So when I paint and I do chipping and the decals and the markings, that's all one area of the modeling for me. The weathering, in simplistic terms, is just getting the model dirty. So the chips are not part of weathering in my process vernacular of what I'm trying to do. So when I paint a model, when I paint this stuff, the chipping and all this stuff, that's all part of the painting process to me. Because what I want to do is I want to have it all done early as possible in the process of the model. And why? Is because the weathering will reduce or enhance those chips and marks and scratches and all that stuff that is important to you at the end of the day, so that if I were to chip later on, I have the ability, because I chipped early on, to do like a new level of markings or a new level. I can do another layer of chips on top of it. So that kind of really gives me a flexibility, if you will. So by doing all my painting and chipping in the beginning, I have the choice later on to do anything else I want to do. Versus if I was to chip later in the, you know, in other words, all the chips look new. And that's when you look at the stuff and you're like, man, that doesn't look quite right. It's because when you chipped and when you weathered is kind of out of sync. And so what I'm trying to say is I do get all the stuff in here, so all the painting, so everything that I do with that thing is all about trying to get those chips and scratches and marks and all that stuff in the paint already handled, so I don't have to worry about it anymore. And that's a nice little thing to do. It's a nice little thing to do.
They are just cleaning it with thinner, or
yeah,
they have a specific cleaner?
No, this thinner, again, everything that the Mission Models thing is do, these, it's all designed to be part of a system. Yes, you can blend it with other paints and other brands if you want to. I see no reason to, unless you just absolutely have a gallon of thinner or something that you must use. They don't quite work super well with the lacquer thinners and some of the other stuff we're used to. So if you are to try these out, definitely you have to do the whole system. It's not expensive or anything. The reason you buy it, yes, you have to pay for it, but these are pure paints, they're not pre-thinned. So they have a long, long shelf life. And a little bit goes a long way because we discussed that. Do I want the pre-thinned airbrush paints? Do I want whatever? Well, those always have problems because when you start to break a chemical down with thinner, it'll have a shelf life. And it will be affected by weather quite easily, to be honest with you. And we learned this from our chemists, that if you were to ship paint overseas through the wintertime, the freezing process at the airports or whatever, if it's really cold, and if it's a pre-thin, broken down paint, it'll affect the paint. So if I get a shipment of Vallejos or whatever over the wintertime, and they're not working properly, and I'm like, what is wrong with the paints now? Half the time it's the weather is affected because they break down. So we've decided to really stick to a pure paint. You know, long shelf life. You add what you need into it when you need to do it, and it becomes a very efficient. So this is twice the paint for almost the same price that you would get with the other bottle. So it's kind of, as a modeler, I'm like, okay, I'm trying to, you know, same thing with the books. I try to find a little bit something extra that we can push and you know, whatever. So it's this. I learned a lot about chemicals when we were working with that.
Do they have any plans to have a European?
Mottobau Koenig in Germany already has them, all of them. There's big UK, Eastern Europe, they're only a couple months old. So they're going to have a whole range of automotive colors.
Ordering from Germany is very good, so.
Yeah. So there's that. Okay, so now. Okay, so I've got my layer of color down. I'm going to spray more white on top of this. Did I pull that out over there? Oh, I got to get that. Okay, so hairspray. Distance is important. The aerosols, this one, this little travel guy, so this guy pressure is a little bit different. I'm not doing that. You know, just get enough on there. Dry this up real quick and do another little bit of it. One quick little more here. One second. Let me get a bottle of white paint. Hold on. And they have the little, you can hear it, they've got the mixer thing in as well. Try to think of everything. Okay. So I'm just going to stick in the same scheme of this tractor real quick. I'm going to put more, and that's just because it was already pre-painted. If I'd done this on a, if this was just a resin model or something, you would have had a primer layer to seal it, and then the rust color first, and then spray the white. Just because it was already white, I just kind of, I'm doing an extra little bit here. I'm just going real quick with this too. This is not, I'm not being super precise with anything for you guys. My white's gonna, and when you play with whites, just the conversation while I'm doing this, oftentimes when I work with a white paint, I will actually, I'll actually put a drop or two. So when I do my whitewashes in particular, when I did this, this is actually supposed to be like a white scheme, but I put a drop of just a tint of a gray or a tan into it all the time. When you deal with color, when you deal with a pure color, like a white or a black, you're starting with a 0 or 100, whatever kind of a thing, you need to kind of have like a 10% first, because then you can come back in and put in your pure colors on top of it, and you can create a more layered, like on the whitewash on this, it's kind of a dirty white, but that gives me the chance to come back in with a pure white and do some other stuff. And so when you have that, you working with certain colors, you kind of pick that up. So I do put a little bit of a drop of color. Oh, that came out nice. So it's just a hint of an off-white now. And that will be different from the white that's in there. Oops. I'm ruining their tablecloth over here.
It's okay.
Yeah. How are we doing on time? Does anybody know? Okay, good. This is all the part I hate doing the demos with. You know, I try to skip up this because it's boring to sit there watching me do all this stuff. Just do with that brush. Okay. Just real quick. A little bit too thin, but I'm just going to make it work. I need to get kind of I'm trying to get just a quick little paint layer on this because I'm a little bit too thin and I don't want to get it too wet. So I'm going to build this up for a second. There it goes. I put too much thinner in the paint. That's because I'm hurrying. Let's just make this. So this particular paint is a little bit more of a precision type of mixing ratios. And so when you're in a hurry like this a little bit, and I should slow down to go faster, that whole rule. You get kind of in your old habits, you know, thinning stuff 50-50 or, you know, rather relatively heavily with some of the colors. So it just wasn't working. So I apologize. Thank you. This will be good for demonstration. All right, so moving along. Speed is up. Okay, that's good enough for what I'm going to do with this for now. So what I'm trying to do is I'm going to basically rust this whole top part up a little bit for you guys just to show you some chipping and some whatever. So we're going to do this. I got my water over here, fresh paper towels. Okay, the old mighty hairspray chipping. I typically use still water for this, but we're not today. So this will be fun. I don't know if the carbonation will have any effect on whatever we're doing, but. Okay, so with the hairspray stuff, your base colors are the color of the chips, the hairspray layer, and then the top coat of the vehicle paint, whatever it is that you're doing. And I know this is gonna be really delicate. Yeah, see, okay, this is good. It'll be easy. Okay, so notice that I don't have a lot of water on the brush right now. A lot of times it takes a little bit to get going. I tend to roll into this real slow. I don't soak a lot of the area first, because if it backfires on you, then you're in trouble. So if I can kind of go in a little bit slow and a little bit easier. Starts to go. And I can feel the grittiness in the paint fighting me, and that's a good feeling because I'm getting really, really refined, small marks, small chips. Push the brush different ways, move it around. And one of the nice things with this particular process, besides the fact that it's a little meditative and it's a little bit therapeutic, what's happening right now in the overall capacity of the model, the storytelling, I'm starting to get what I like to call the roadmap happening. By doing this early on, by putting all this process up front, what I'm doing now, these little marks, these little effects that I'm getting, and some of it I'm fighting a little bit, some of it I'm not, but I'm not super worried about it, because what's going to happen is, with the oil paints and some of the other stuff, I'm gonna have some ability to kind of losing my train of thought here. An ability to, with this right now, I'm creating kind of the roadmap. And with the roadmap, I can then, over the course of time, like I said with the Hetzer there, know what I'm, now I know in my head as I'm looking at this, you know, what I'm gonna rust out, what I'm gonna chip, and actually my rust color looks more like the body orange color anyway, so I'm not really sure what I was trying to do here. But we'll fix it. We can fix a lot of the stuff with the oils and get a little bit more dynamic look of this right away. But right now, the early stages of the chips are and notice how I use the sides of the brush. I use the bristles. I poke at it a little bit. I stab it a little bit. I do various things with it. Sometimes I'll scuff and scrub it a little bit if I need a little bit more. It's starting to come to life a little bit here too now. See the brushwork, you can do different things. And right now, because this is going to be somewhat of a more extreme piece that I'm going to do, I'm not super concerned on the quality as far as it being hyper accurate or hyper precise at this time. I only want to make sure I have a nice variety of small and large and kind of nice random effects. And if I was using a reference photo, if I had vehicle reference photos that I was using while I'm doing this, it kind of guides you along of adding in. The hairspray is wonderful adding in the natural randomness effect that we're trying to achieve. It's wonderful for that. But at the same time, you still are the, you know, you're the master of it. So you still have to kind of go through the process of doing it to create those things, to get that kind of look. And
if it's a bigger model or bigger panel or something, do you break it into parts or chip at once?
For example, like if it's an aircraft, the whole thing, do the one section. So at least
like
the section's
done. For example?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Because
it'll be a little bit easier to manage.
Because you can chip so easy.
Yeah. Yes, because so you have a time factor. You have a time element involved.
Can you add some index drop
mm-hmm.
or two?
Mm-hmm.
To
absolutely.
Make it easier later?
And you can do that. You can do you can also control how much paint you put down. Can vary your time element by the opacity of the paint. So if you have a situation where, like the Hetzer here is, it's all hairsprayed and it's all painted. So I can achieve the chipping in one session, or I can do some of it and then I can come back within a couple of days and still be able to chip it. Sometimes
you have to add something stronger like water.
Not really. I don't change that too much.
Index alcohol.
Usually with the Windexes though is you're going to get kind of a reductive process, a little bit more of a. What I'm trying to say here is, to answer your question, no, I don't. So to answer your question, no. But Windex in itself with the hairspray is also a thing. So you can
but
maneuver.
If you leave it for 1 to 10 days, mm-hmm. then it's very hard to chip.
It can be because there is, but if it's sealed and I could probably a couple weeks do that. So if you're concerned about that, then paint in different sessions, so you have to modify your work a little bit to if you're not going to do it, and that if you're going to do an aircraft and you think you'll do this one thing and then this maybe a month later, then you can paint separately or you can hairspray and chip separately, you know, at least get the base colors going and stuff. I try not to be honest with you. I try to get everything painted, everything hairsprayed, everything sealed up, and then get the chipping done in 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 days. Get that done. Most of my subjects, this is the size I work in a lot, just the, so if I don't have anything this big, usually it's probably its own beast, you know, a 32nd scale aircraft or some of those wing things that are, you know,
like
massive.
Like Nikes, but 118.
Yeah, it could be a little bit different. If it's this big, you know, it could take you a couple of hours for side to chip, so you may be 2 or 3 days, but I still try to get it all going in one whole thing, so that's kind of what I'm doing, so. But then I also kind of, I don't have the luxury of time per se sometimes, so I think maybe it's different for me, so I've not been involved where I needed to really break it, you know, come back a month later and chip something else. I just never have that problem, so, because I'm always trying to move forward, so. And I think this is because I'm busy with this stuff. But I don't do any special additives, even with the Windex and stuff, so. So this is probably good enough to at least demo with and keep going here real quick.
Okay, so this is pretty solid. Some of this is extra. Sometimes, especially with white, when you do white chipping, the little flakes of paint that come off, they kind of bunch up a little bit, so sometimes you have to kind of scrape them off and get them out of there. And then white tends to tint the base colors a lot, so if you're doing like German armor, make sure your pans are, if you're doing a whitewash and you're using white paint in particular, make sure your Dunkelgelbs and your Panzergraus are dark. The darker it is, the better it will be, because if you do that kind of trendy pale shade of Panzer Gray and you do a whitewash, it's just going to look like a really pale white tank thing. It doesn't work. So you want to make sure if you're using the whitewash, your base colors are strong and powerful, because the white will really, really affect it. So you want to get a little bit better results at the end of the day with that. Because I get that question asked quite a bit. What color, you know, gray do I use for whatever with the whitewash? Okay, so we've got our hairspray chipping kind of for this purpose of demonstration. We're far enough along. Moving right into the oils. This guy out of the way. So, and this is why I brought this one. This is after. This little towel is from chipping this guy and doing the oil paints with the Hetzers. These are like my little, you know, these things are the. I cannot live without the paper towel.
You can frame it and hang it.
Yeah. So this is, I show you this because this is, you're seeing how I work all the time. You're seeing how I do what I do. There's nothing I do at home. I don't have anything different here. What you're seeing me do right now is exactly how I do this at home, and all that kind of fun stuff. I often have little things because, you know, if you need to get like an angle, I always have little blocks of foam or wood or whatever to kind of prop the model up with to kind of do some things. And this is exactly how I work. So this is, I think it's fun for you guys to kind of see that. Okay, so we've got the two colors here. And actually, I'm gonna use, oftentimes when I'm doing multiple colors, if I have a range of colors that's in the whites, the tans or whatever, I'll have a brush just for those colors. And if I'm doing the rusts and the darker browns and stuff, there's a brush for that. And then there's a couple thinner brushes. So my hands tend to get full of brushes and colors and whatnot, but that's okay, because that's what you want. You want to have this flexibility to maneuver. So I'm just loading some color up into some of these brushes. And again, watch my hand work. This isn't, you know, watch how much I put on the brush. And then I'm always unloading it and all this kind of stuff. This is the dance, if you will. I'm just kind of prepping it. And what I'm looking for is, right now I'm just looking for just kind of a nice, I've got like a pure white with a little bit in there, a little bit of thinner. The brush is, I can see it's a little bit wet when I look up close to it, but it's not glossy wet. And so what I can do is I can come in here and, this is my first, you know, trying to, because the white on the model now is darker than a pure white, I can come in with a brighter color and start to do some stuff in here. And this is what I'm talking about. When I came up with the term, the oil paint rendering, this is the reason why. It's to explain the process to what I'm doing. You know, I'm working with oils. Well, that doesn't tell you anything. And so by giving that kind of rendering term, which is an artistic illustration term, I'm basically redrawing in many sections here. Specifically, if you notice, I'm just coming in here. It's, look at the brush, look at the tip that I'm, you know, watch what I'm doing here, of how close, and this kind of, with the, getting the paint back onto the brush and then applying it to, you know, it's hyper delicate, it's very refined, it's control and precision, it's all the things I've talked about. It's a 1/43 die cast model, and I'm doing the exact same thing I did on the 35th scale Hetzer. And this is what I'm trying to get across to you guys in that important conversation about things. And as I sit here, and you know, this is a fresh model for me, so I'm trying to, my brain while I'm talking to you is trying to decide what to do here, but I'm not losing control. I've got kind of a little bit of a whitewash effect, I guess you can call it. So this is kind of the same technique for military guys. And all I'm doing is I'm kind of popping it. You may not even be able to see this from where you're at or even on the TV, I can't tell, but I'm getting a nice little layered white around this heavier chipping area. And then when the heavier chipping area, I can come in with my with a little bit. Let me get that color. That was the wrong process. Let me get this color out. I'll get some darker. Let's get some. I'll build in some kind of enhanced contrast for you guys, so you can kind of see what I talk about a little bit easier. So I can come back in here. So I'm adding kind of a darker, this would be kind of that, you know, when steel rusts, that really deep brown, charcoal brown color. And because I'm so precise with this, you know, again, this is oil paint. This is, you know, there's nothing crazy going on right now. Trying to get more of a clean blending brush here. Gets a lot of the thinner out. And I can just soften the effect a little bit, blend it out a little bit more. And so now what's happened, why that oil paints have become so powerful, was so unique, is because I'm able to, within a little short span of time, apply direct amount of color, control it, fade, chip. You know, I can do a variety of effects almost immediately. And now that little, this is already starting to come alive in here, in that little tiny little moment of whatever. And this is nothing, you know, what happened here is just nothing special. It's not the, you know, this is not like a gold medal, there's nothing like that. What I'm just trying to do is show you guys just the ability of what you can do with this. I'm not trying to impress you per se with making this look super, super awesome, cool. But it will be, but you know. So I'm going to show you here. If I go a little bit too crazy, a little bit too much, this is, you know, working fast. You'll see a lot of guys do this, and that's okay, because I know with oil paints and everything else, I can come in here and knock this back, pull it back into scale, get that effect. You guys can see this okay? So if you need me to turn it or move it, let me know. Because I can't see what I'm doing for what you guys see on the screen there. Come in here and just kind of pull some of the color into the, you know, just kind of start to really, I'm starting to weather the model now. I'm starting to add a little bit of life and you know, all this stuff is starting to happen, and it's very controllable, it's very easy.
Painted.
Yes, and that's, I talk about that actually. This is a second paint job. And again, it does take patience. It does take time. In my opinion, this hobby is to enjoy. It's not a race to me. It's not who's first to the thing to get whatever. That's all personal. That's all very personal to you. If time is in the hurry, and yeah, I have deadlines and those kind of things. Those are the realities of life for me, but at the same time, I'm being efficient, so I'm being precise and quick about this, but I'm not in a hurry, and there's a difference. And you can just see how delicate I'm being, how gentle I'm being, the brush control, the precise, it's two or three brushes, and so on and so forth, and that's kind of, and I'm not super out of scale with this. This is 1/43rd. You know, and I'm just kind of letting the chipping that I'd already done kind of talk to me. You know, I'm looking at it and just kind of as I'm starting to settle into this model now, even while I'm discussing and talking with you guys, you can already kind of see that the just it's starting to happen. You know, and civilian vehicles are, in my opinion, I think there's opportunities to weather things with other colors, because in the real world, if this was a vehicle that sat in a really moist climate, you're going to get some fungus, you're going to get some other colors here. I can use some greens, I can use some yellows. We're going to put this on here and we can do some stuff. And that becomes, I think civilian stuff, when I actually get into it, it's going to be a lot of fun. You know, there's really going to be some cool things you can do here, and so.
And you're more free then.
Yeah. And there's a pleasure in particular, like the grill. The grill was built around historical reference. The pattern is to a factory scheme. There's an old AFU modeler article that had all the schematics in it for the paint scheme for the factory and all this stuff. And so there's reward in that. There's precision, historical research reward in that we get as modelers. This stuff to me is because in my particular personal thing, like I love, like we talked about this row one, like I love that too. And it's that freedom, that expression, that artistic ability built around a story that they've created and a world that they've created. And so now how do I make that what that I want it to be, so to speak? Civilians and the robotics and the science fiction and stuff, by applying the precision historical thing that we do with the military side of it into that, I think will really elevate and have, it'll really explode. I think, and it's about to happen. I think you've already seen it with some of the other companies, you're seeing it with some of the other guys that do this professionally, and we're starting to understand, even for me, this is my second or third Gundam that I've played with, you know, one, two, that's my third one that I'm playing with, and it's like, okay, I can see where if I do my markings with my hairspray and my chipping and I really refine it, I get some really cool things on this, but it's science fiction piece, so it's like the enjoyment factor is really fun, and I'm not, you know, so there's a balance for me because I enjoy going really historical, and then, you know, stepping away and doing something really structured. And then like the little orange Bergepanzer crane thing on the very end there, that little 1/72nd scale was kind of based off a semi-quasi-historical thing, and then pretend that it was in a timeline 30 years later in an old field, that kind of a thing, which is kind of half of this over here. So I enjoy kind of the balance and kind of the flow of all those things, and there's something, and the hobby to me is, that's in my first, like when you guys wonder like the motivation and stuff, that to me is the, I love that kind of stuff. Definitely, definitely love that kind of stuff. So speaking of a little bit of the... Again, you can see I'm just getting a little bit of color. I'm really delicate. I'm going to make up a lime fungus green shade here, a little bit like a mossy kind of a light green. And sometimes the first times when you start to work with the colors, or you have to kind of, some of like the greens start to dry really quick, just because of the type of pigments that they have in them. So you just have to kind of work with it a little bit in the beginning to get them going. I think it's an older tube of paint too. I think it's kind of started to lose its luster. There you go. So right now I'm just kind of working with my palette. And when I'm working on a project, by the end of a project, that tends to be the paint's just kind of, it's kind of everywhere, and that's okay because that's, you know, that shows to me that the level of creativity and enthusiasm and some of the other things I was doing was working, because I was excited and getting some stuff in here. I always have brushes in my mouth too, so. I use the side of the bristle to run the edges like a little bit like a dry brushing process. And again, if there's like a spot or a stain, there's often little tiny little marks around it as well as the oxidation has occurred in patterns. But because I've speckled on these spots in very random little spots, it's already on there. So now all I'm doing is I'm just going back through and I'm working with what I already did to kind of enhance and
break some stuff up, add some other stuff. So it's a very fluid, very, very maneuverable, very flexible process, and this is actually starting to look really interesting. You know, it's starting to look like little bubbles of rust coming through the paint that happens with older older projects, older vehicles and stuff. Are we doing girdle? Yeah.
You have still a half an hour, right?
Okay, beautiful.
Okay.
Okay, I probably will switch to the Gundam here.
Okay, no worries.
So, with the speckling, I can then do that, and then let's put a little bit, where's my white? So what I'm trying to do is now is I'm starting to increase the layers of effects that are happening. And the speckling is a wonderful, wonderful, easy, super, super efficient way to, you're kind of spitting on some color a little bit, because if you're in the military world and you like that kind of stuff, you know, like I mentioned this yesterday, we have a lot of these beautiful high resolution wartime photos now, and you know, close-ups of the crew figures and the hatches, and you can see all this grime, and it could be a newer vehicle, could just be delivered to the field, but it's been a week in the boat and been delivered. You see all these little tiny little things in the paint now. This is what I'm trying to do. This is what I'm trying to put in here. So I'm gonna add a little bit of a darker white color in here a little bit. And it's, you see how delicate this is? See how close I am to the model? And then I can add a little bit of thinner, and I can get a little bit more of a diffuse spot. And these are hyper subtle. They're super delicate. They're not intended to be overwhelming. It's starting to and you know, we'll look at this when we're done, but it's starting to really kind of come alive over here, and I can switch my colors to more of a pure white. Get little flecks of white paint in there, because whatever happens, just kind of, that's how it happens in the real world. So we're just trying to, and there's really no other way to do this. You know, I mean, you could try to do this by hand, but there's no point because this is so easy. It's a great way to flick on dust, of course. And there's the airbrushing way too, you could do that. I mean, that's a much more heavy-handed process. But for what I'm trying to do, the purpose of what I'm trying to do here is adding kind of layers of just super subtle little tiny little gritty spots and stuff, and as this thing starts to come alive a little bit, there's all these little marks and happenings and just the wear and tear and the fading and whatever, and it's all starting to happen now. And it's been a half hour, 45 minutes or whatever it's been, and so I can quickly get to a level where I'm comfortable with this, and I'm gonna move to the Gundam just because we're gonna run out of time here, but same thing. So it's kind of what that is, and that's what I did with the aircraft wing here. That's what we did yesterday with the Hetzer thing here.
Sir, give me the seat director.
Yeah. Just grab it by the wheels. It's a little wet on top. So, all right. So the Gundams, you get to. The beauty of these is these little guys are, you know, basically snap together kits.
May I ask you something?
Yes. I did. I went to a university for car design, so I'm formally trained in color theory. Composition is important as well. So yeah, and that's how I'm able to transition. But a lot of those skills are applicable, and you know, it's been a fun to use that and to move forward. And
have you glued any of the Gundam,
this is okay. So these Gundams, just to talk about this real quick, these guys are they're an interesting level of kit. I'm new to Gundam. Some of you that have used them before, played with them before, or whatever you do with them, if you take it seriously, you know, they're very moved joints. The Japanese genius of the construction, you know, where they snap together, there's very little glue involved, there's very little sanding involved with some of the newer, more impressive kits. But again, there's a layer of primer on this to protect the paint. There's a layer of hairspray on top of that. And then to the question of time with the hairspray, you asked me earlier, you know, so this is a couple days old now. I can come in here with some water if I wanted to do a little bit more. And this one was nice because I got some nice little faded effects, but there's all these little ridges and stuff to play with in the high spots. So just trying to, you know, getting a little bit of a wear and tear on the thing, and just imagining this, you know, this, and there's probably a lot less accuracy involved with this type of work. But the beauty of it is I'm getting some really nice faded coloring effects in here. And oftentimes when I'm doing this, you'll see me earlier, I will cover the thinner so I don't actually by accident go to from water to, that happens a lot. So what I'll do here, so I've got to the conversation of that Star Wars inspiration and stuff like that.
All brushes are the same size?
Everything. I've just, yeah.
What's the size?
These are just, it's a number two round, but this particular brand has a nice bristle length, so it's a little bit longer than some number twos are a little bit shorter, but, and it holds a point really, it's like a nice figure brush. It holds a point and can hold enough chemical, paint, whatever I'm doing, thinner, for what I need to do, and it doesn't dry out, and they're $4 or $5 US a piece, so I buy them in packs. This is, I don't think you get them here in Europe, but it's Loa Cornell. Yeah. But anything similar, these are just synthetics. These are nothing special. They're, you know, I chew them up and spit them out. They tend to go pretty quickly. Okay, so basically the same process as the tractor. Again, all identical. Come in here to my oils. So let's, and now I can start playing. This is going to be a little bit more fun because I can play with a little bit more color. So not everything that you do with these, with the modeling, is about, you know, chipping and rusting and all that stuff. You know, there's the color modulation theories, there's a figure painting stuff, there's a lot of other conversations going on about, you know, what goes on and how we do things. And so the oil paints, the reason I really enjoy this so much now is I'm basically applying a bluish filter to this, in this panel. Without resorting to any other, you know, type of process. This is just kind of a general. So just using the color scheme of the subject matter in this particular case is kind of a bluish green gray. So it's a nice little thing. So again, same idea. I'm trying to get this so you can guys trying to position sort of. There we go. Okay. So I've tinted a little section in here. Adding a little bit of layers of speckled color. And these will show up when it dries. You'll see the texture that it creates. You'll see kind of the random. There's some things that happen with this stuff, with the speckling. It's a really nice little way to kind of. So not everything is always a smooth, blended, soft. You want a little bit of grit, as I call it, kind of a. And I can come in here with, switch off the green. And this is, you see, I'm not really doing anything different. I'm using the vehicle's kind of shapes and stuff as an advantage. And I've really in a short period of time, I've started to really rework. So what I've done is you've noticed I've got kind of the faded, painted, chipped areas here with kind of a wider, lighter color. I've bordered that up with a darker tone here to enhance the step of the panel because this front knee pad thing is on top of the other one. So now, in the traditional sense of modeling, again, it's the same conversation I showed you over here. In the traditional sense, we would do this. We would come in and we would do a panel line. You know, we would do our washes and we would do our, you know, we would do this over here, you know, and then we come over and we do some other things. And so this step by step thing is the same conversation I had over here. What I've done now is I've changed that around to where I've done my tinting, I've done my washes, I've done speckling, I've done all these things in that one little section right there one time. So that's what I'm talking about, where you can use these techniques on anything that you want to do, whatever subject matter that you want to use them in, and you just use the vehicle itself, the subject matter itself will kind of guide you in how to do that. And that to me is kind of the changeover with it. So I'm gonna kind of fix this little thing here. And notice when I blend out with a thinner, if it's something like an aircraft or something where you have a lot of panel lines, blend your thinners to the lines. That avoids the tide marks. It's another way to avoid the tide marks. It's a little bit easier. And then if you've got to, you know, if you have to dry it real quick. So now in a real quick, I have no tide marks to deal with. I've got this really interesting little weathered panel in here already happening. That to me is kind of a neat little thing. And then what you do is you can, again, to the point of what happens when you start to put more oils on top of oils that you just used a couple of minutes ago. It's not that big of a deal because I've already kind of dried most of it out. And what you're seeing me do right here was exactly how I did the legs, the white and orange legs for that other robot right there. Sometimes it's too wet, unload the brush. Don't be afraid of anything like that. Don't be afraid to start the brush over, or even clean it up and start it fresh. Sometimes you have to. Sometimes when the sessions go really long. I'm adding a little bit of a darker, greasier color to the top of the blue and just kind of trying to pull it into that. But you can see that there's no thinner blending out, there's no bleeding of stuff, there's no color bleed, there's no running of. So in essence, I've kind of done both a filter and a wash at the same time in the same section. And like right, one thing that happens that's really, really nice when it starts to, because it's hard to control a little bit, the brush is drying out on me a little bit. There's almost no thinner. So now I can kind of have a really soft, cloudy little, it's basically dry brushing with an oil, which is a really nice little effect that you can get and use to your advantage. So all these kind of techniques that we've had at our disposal for years and years and years, I'm not disposing of them. I'm not throwing them away. I'm just